question.
Records.
What's an object?
Records.
Yeah, we like records.
Yeah, we do.
Hey everyone, just to let you know, I did that live stream last Friday, and I have all those records for sale on my Discogs, so you can see what's available. If you want to get any of those, you can see what I have, and get in touch directly, and it'll be a little bit cheaper, the whole nine yards, you know. Yeah, I recorded this next video about a week and a half, yeah, a little over a week ago, so I wanted to give you that info if you're interested. Put the link below in my Discogs, so check it out.
It's your old pal Dom. Back talking to himself again into a camera, seeking a thread, bringing back the real juicy episodes I call Vinyl Absorption. This is the fourth in the series, which I launched this year in terms of sort of focusing the list of records that are new to me into a more concise pile where I've listened and sort of more thoughtful and more engaging comments we'll say about everything. And these tend to be a little on the long side, but I do have less titles. We'll see what we get. We'll put samples in between. I want to thank everybody for joining in on the Acid Archives. It's been great to see some new channels. Dave the VC Ambassador, aka Local Bandography, back doing some videos. Well, I don't know if he'll stick, but he's definitely engaged in the Acid Archives. Chris Kibler, you know, talked about Vinyl Piper and Crazy Jimmy, and Mazzy's been into it, and Alex did a great one. We'll see who else wants to join. Of course, Psychedelic. Hopefully I'm not forgetting somebody. Probably. Sorry. But there is a playlist. I'll link to it below. Yeah, it's been a quiet January. I was hot and heavy, and I'm still talking through records I bought in January and even last year, so that's what's here in this pile. February I slowed down, March I slowed down even more. And so now, I've talked a little bit about it, but you know, I've got a bunch going on financially, so it's sort of probably good timing where I can just get into the records I've bought over the last 3 months that I'm still barely even heard. My birthday was about a month ago. I bought a pretty nice pile of interesting stuff for An Angry Mom, which happened to come in from a used collection of stuff. I haven't shown any of that. VCLT is coming in. I'm working through the Chris Cole VCLT over Christmas time, which one of them will be here tonight, so I'm excited to kind of sit back, relax a bit, and enjoy what I have, though there's been a few choice things I've grabbed recently, so we'll get to it at some point. Things I'm getting, like, over the few things I've gotten in the last month, we may not see in this avenue, or in this setting for like 3 or 4 months, but whatever. Thanks everybody. There's been a bunch of stuff going on with Material Objects. Talk about that at some point. I've got 3 Acid Archives videos in the can to be premiered soon. So let's start with some singles. This I made reference to an order I made from the UK in January when I was a bit heavy with records. And this is the last of the stuff I've been processing. It was a bunch of pretty small, relatively inexpensive stuff. A few more expensive ones, but I got 3 singles here. This is the first one here, Normal Hawaiians. I have a compilation with some unreleased music and some singles. And I have one of their LPs, but I didn't have this single. This is from 1981. This is sort of the art rock, post-punk sort of thing. It's on the Illuminated label, which I have another single in this pile on that label. Guy Smith was the leader of this band. Didn't really do a whole lot after this, but throughout all the different lineup changes, he was the one constant. This is definitely a band The most well-known of the bands I'm going to show, these 7 Inches anyway, is their second single from 1981, Illuminated. I'll do a quick snippet. Show you the label real quick. This is a UK release. These are all UK pressings. Illuminated discs. So we have that. Yeah, I love to get English post-punk, you know. Another one on the Illuminated label. This is Dormammu. This one I happened upon as I went through the dealer's other stuff. I believe it's partially missing the cover sleeve. This is Illuminated number 24 from 1983. Simeon vocals, guitar, bass. Mike vocals, percussion. Marcus or trio. This is very much dub inflected, industrial, a little funky, a little bit of Gang of Four. They have 3 EPs. This is, I think, their 3rd one. And it is good. There it is. Not a very prolific band at all. None of these are. These are all pretty obscure, pretty deep UK post-punk groups. And the last one, this is also related to the label. There's some crossover amongst the Illuminated label and this label, Dining Out. This is Club Tango. This is probably my favorite of the bunch. This is from, let's see, oh, the year, I have it down here, 1981. And this is definitely women-based post-punk. And this is kind of an EP, technically, 3 tracks. Pretty big release discography for this label, at least for this time. 21 releases on the Dining Out label. You know, a lot of the small DIY UK punk labels, it was like 2 or 3. But this is a little more on the new wave side of things. 1981, Club Tango. So 2 tracks. Oh, this is just 2 tracks. I think the Normal Wines is actually the EP. Club Tango, FTN, and Get the Picture, Dining Out. Oh, it's got the release date on it, 29/7/81, July 29th, 81. Okay. Some nice little post-punk stuff there. I'll use that in a DJ set at some point. To LPs, we get to a classic. This is very much not related, but this is a Ethnographic LP on the great French label Okora. This is one of the classic Okoras, the original pressing, the Burundi Musique de Burundi. This is the first pressing. I got this in Sweden. I was watching this copy just kept releasing, decreasing in price. I ended up getting down to, I think, 30 euro. And I was able to get something else from the dealer. And originally, I think it was Brahma Records. It started at like 60 or 40, 50 or 60. And over the last 6 months, I've just been watching it. And I finally got to a place where I felt like paying for the plane ticket. And this is just insane, insanely good. And sometimes even just insane sounding. Like the first track, the chant with like a zither type instrument, the kithar, he's like whispering. It almost sounds like no wave. It's crazy. Burundi is kind of southern east. It's next to what, Tanzania? Yeah, here's a map right there in the sleeve. This is from 1960. Do I have the year? It's mid 60s. And if you're wondering what we're listening to, I'll tell you in a second because we're going to get to it. But Burundi is a country less than 30,000 kilometers in area, situated south of the equator in the region of undulating contours to the east of Democratic Republic of Congo. Pretty small. You have, bordered by Rwanda, Tanzania. There's a bunch of different lakes in that region. But you have, this is all recorded is it Charles Duval? Maybe I think that's who recorded it, I guess. It's my French. But here we go. I mean, the booklet is attached. And there's some really cool, like, children doing, like, this. Almost sounds like they're overdubbing their voices to a really great effect. It's just, when it comes to basically folk music of the African continent, this is like highest of the highest order. Just so interesting, just the sounds they're getting. There's an ensemble of drums that sort of closes it out. Jouer de kitha inaga, I think that's maybe even a still from the first track. A beautiful album. Oh, this is Okora number 40. This is an absolute essential Okora to have. I'm sure I'm speaking to the choir for those that know your Okora label, so I'll put in something about that. Just great artwork and it's the whole 9 yards. It's the whole package. We're listening to the brand new album from Rafael Toral. I know a few of you out there are singing the praise of this, or certainly are excited to get it. This is his brand new album, and in many ways it's the first it's the first since he's sort of closed out his space station or whatever he was doing. He was doing like an audio space program with the guitar, essentially. Or, I'm sorry, not so much the guitar. This is his return to the guitar, but he was doing this audio space program. He's from Portugal. And this is a return to sort of just making sort of grounded music. And the whole record feels like it starts like a palindrome. Like it starts in this place, and it goes to a place, and then it goes back to where it started, sort of like a Ouroboros in a way. Like it starts in this ambient, sort of unsettled ambient. I love that how it Toral plays with dissonance but beauty at the same time. Like it's kind of will put you on an edge a little bit, but then it smooths out. And it's a stunning side. We're listening to the first side. He plays all the guitars, bass, and electronic instruments. Recorded and mixed from 2020 to 2022. And this is on Jim O'Rourke's label that has just been resurrected, Mokai, which is basically a Drag City distributed label. Drag City reissued some of his other records. I don't know if it's out of print or waiting repress, but it's definitely, I think it's sold out in a lot of places right away, so look for it. Stunning cover here. He's basically improvising. He's improvising with electronics, so it's like he's taking what is typically an instrument that you would program and improvising with them. And it's kind of like, I read about him, like he liked to think of this as like free jazz, but with electronics. A lot of things being left to chance, and the guitar kind of fills in everything else. Mokai is Jim O'Rourke's label. Spectral Evolution, just out. See if it's out there. We're listening to it right now. Beautiful record. Certainly will be a contender for one of my favorite records of the year. Franco Battiato. Pollution. Or actually, this is Fetus Pollution. It's a compilation of Pollution and Fetus. Two different albums for the Italian avant-garde composer, experimentalist, Franco Battiato. Italian. This came from Chris Cole. The original record is from 72-73, and this is sort of a little confusing because it takes some of both of those releases and I think adds something else to it. But Battiato was very much a well-known Italian almost superstar, you might say. You know, living in that bit of folk psych, singer-songwriter, prog, avant-garde. He kind of was well-known, I think, somewhat well-known in Italy. He was part of this group early on called the Osage Tribe, which was recorded on the label Blah Blah, which is a... It's in my want list. I'll never see it, but there are reissues of it. A stunning psychedelic progressive record. So yeah, these were the Fetus and Pollution essentially were his solo records following the Osage Tribe. Osage Tribe, and this is sort of a compilation of those. And this is an Italian pressing on the Orizzonte label. Really cool, Chris. Yeah, it's kind of like, feels like a sweet type of thing with avant-garde electronics and sort of interesting arrangements. Doesn't sound like anything else. Light in the Attic did reissues of the proper albums. Those proper albums, Fetus and Pollution, are pretty hard to come by. Yeah, some pretty like schizophrenic transitions and stuff too. So this is a cool one. Really good. Chris knows what I would like here. Not from 1972, this comp. I think it's from like the early 80s. I'm not sure why it says 1972. I don't believe it is anyway. I think, well, the original Fetus was anyway. This compilation, I don't know, it's from later, but it is an Italian pressing. So thank you, Chris. Making my way through the VCLT. It's got almost through all of it. And by through, I don't mean I'm like looking to just move it on. It's just I want to sort of properly take it in and absorb it. I don't know if I've discussed it much, but I don't own any Sun Ra Saturn pressings until now. I got one that was, there's a couple that are really important to me to getting because it's a local tie-in, a local connection. And this is one of, and there's another one I want to get, which I don't have yet, but this is one I really wanted to bring home at some point because it obviously, like I said, there's a local connection. And somebody in Canada put this up with an offer, and I was able to get this for, I think, a great price. I mean, the Sun Ra Saturn stuff is astronomical, but I was really happy to get this one, and it's in great, great shape too. This is My Brother the Wind. Look at the color. Colored in by Sun Ra, or the band, or whatever. It's the first pressing. This is a Saturn Research label. It's from 1970. I'll show you the good old El Saturn, or Saturn Research, same thing. Yeah, it's great shape. This is got deep groove labels too. So, I won't get too into the history of Sun Ra, but at this time he was starting to explore the Moog synthesizer. And at this time, 15 minutes down the road from me, in a town called Trumansburg, I'm in upstate New York, in Ithaca, Bob Moog, Robert A. Moog, was settled into that exact town. And I have photographs. I'm going to show you the old photograph of the factory and the new photograph of the factory. He was there, I think, since the early to mid-60s. And at this time, late 1960s, 1970, he was developing a stage version of the Moog, known as the Mini Moog, for bands to take on tour and things. And Sun Ra wanted to check this out. And most importantly, he was just getting into using the Moog on records. So he got it. So before he visited, he would come to visit Moog here in Trumansburg in 1970 to check out the Mini Moog because he was going to use it on tour and he was going to record with it, which he would do in the factory, which is actually Volume 2, Night of the Purple Moon. Volume 1 is My Brother the Wind. So he actually recorded this in New York with Gershon Kingsley, who was essentially had a studio with Moog in it. And it's the first record that has... it's the first record in Sun Ra's canon with the Moog. So While this isn't the one that was directly recorded here, the second volume is, The Night of the Purple Moon. This one was important too because it led to his time coming here. And he came up with the whole entourage in the summer of 1970 to see the Mini Moog with, and just totally freaked out the small town that apparently they thought he was his group was stealing things. They went and got ice cream. Obviously, this is not a place where you would see someone like Sun Ra and his whole crew come through, but this is an important one to me, and I still have the reissue, which gives you the whole story and includes further sessions, a further session of the record with Space Probe and The Perfect Man, the complete tracking session. But it does the first A and B side is this album. And I'll just show you the booklet real quick. So yeah, you can see the different variations of My Brother the Wind. And I'm really just happy to have that original now. I do want to get that Night of the Purple Moon, but I'm really thrilled to have this. And here's Bob Moog in the studio. There is the studio. That's what I'll show you. That's where I am. Schumannsburg. That's the factory in 1970, I think. 1971. So what do we have here? This is, like I said, this one, My Brother the Wind, he recorded in New York in 1970. Or 69, released in 70. And it features Gilmore, Marshall Allen, and Danny Davis. But the interesting thing is John Gilmore is playing tenor sax and percussion. He's actually playing drums on this, which is, he was not a drummer. And you can hear that. And he ended up just staying there for a lot of the session. Marshall Allen's doing oboe, piccolo, and flute. Danny Davis, alto sax, clarinet. Yeah, no drum. Well, drums, but not even on the whole thing from Gilmore. So, doing some very haphazard drums. And yeah, it's insane. It's so good. He's basically exploring the possibilities of what the Moog could do. And like I said, he would continue with Night of the Purple Moon, which was recorded partially here, and further explores the synthesizer. I got this in Canada, and I'm so happy to finally have one. I'm not really looking to collect these. You know that's going to be a dumb idea. I passed them up when they were much cheaper years ago. So, but I want to get, I'm really happy to have this and hopefully get the part two, Night of the Purple Moon. My Brother the Wind. Yeah, the whole story on the reissue, and I think this reissue you can get and check out and get the whole story. But so, big piece to the collection here. And a beautiful colored in image sleeve. That's what we're playing now, but ambient. Ariel Kamma, Jeremiah Chu, Marta, Sophia Hohner, Ariel Kamma, the great French experimentalist, ambient composer. This just came out in February, International Anthem. Beautiful release. Maybe a little bit not unexpected, but kind of what you would expect to get from this. So in a way, it's not necessarily going to surprise you in many ways, but it's a lovely document of a session that they did following BBC Three collaboration. The name of the show, I think it tells us here. Yeah, they got together for this Late Junction in September 22 on BBC Three, and then they spun that off into this session, which was recorded last year. And it features Kalma. I'm not sure which parts, but some of these are pieces that were taken from the French archives of the GRM. 1976 to 1980, that he had, he was in possession of, or he had access to. So some of this is archival recordings mixed in with modern sounds and modern experimentation. There they are. The closest thing to silence. This is just the standard black version. I think there's a color. New work from Australian-based legendary French composer Ariel Kalman and the US-based duo of Jeremiah Chu and Marta Sophia Hohner. Evolving from a brief BBC Lake Junction collaboration September 22. And then you get, you know, some hype from International Anthem, but a beautiful release. This is one I've been enjoying. We're going to hear some of this as I talk further. Here's one. This one I got from Michael45's OBC shop. This was a Thomas Busk record, Composer's Workshop Ensemble, Lauren Smith. This is Estrada East. Another one, a label I don't collect, but when I see things for the right price, I go for it. This is still in the shrink. I haven't taken it out yet. I don't like to take them off vintage pressings. We'll see. But it's this label, which I think is technically not the very first. There's some thoughts that it could be. You don't see that Strata East label too often, like a light blue. This is not necessarily... It veers into the avant-garde and modal jazz, but it's definitely a little more... I wouldn't call it traditional at all. A little soul jazz. It maybe is some sort of a post-bop type record. Warren Smith, New York School public teacher. New York public school teacher. We work with Miles Davis, Gil Evans, Max Roach. And he's playing with a pretty big ensemble here. Warren Smith is, of course, a drummer. You also have Jimmy Owens on trumpet, Johnny Coles on trumpet, Herb Bushel bass, Bross Townsend piano. Who else? Julius Watkins, French horn. Al Gibbons, tenor sax. Jackie Jeffers, bass, trombone. Howard Johnson, baritone sax and tuba. 1972. There's a second record, too, on Strata East. Highly enjoyable. Great ensemble record. Let's see. Yeah, we have mostly Warren Smith compositions, I think. Yeah. Except for the first one, C.T. Parkinson. But I really enjoyed this one, and it's a lovely shape from Thomas Busk in Denmark. There's that. For those looking for like free jazz and more avant-garde than anything else, this is not necessarily the record for you, but it is the record for someone who's looking for a little bit of something outside and but still somewhat grounded to some of the sort of traditionalism. But it's on the Strata East label, so you know you can expect it to be somewhat a little bit different, a little bit left of center. So a nice one to add to the collection. Is free, but also not quite as free, and one that I found walks a fine line. Bernd Rosengren, Fly Me to the Sun. This is a original Swedish pressing with some great Scandinavian players. He of course is a tenor sax, and we lost him last year, I believe it was. Bernd is playing tenor, alto, flute, and piano as well. Tommy Coverholt, tenor and flute. Torbjörn Holkrantz, bass. Leif Wennerström, drums and piano. This is recorded September 14th, 1971. Produced by Gunnar Nyberg. I love this one. And there's another record I'm looking for on Harvest by Rosengren. No reissue of this one. It's the one and only release. But he's played with Don Cherry, George Russell. If you know your Swedish jazz, this is a classic, but... he did soundtrack with Krzysztof Komeda and Milan Polanski, so he's known for that. This again, it's really more of a free record, but does sort of lay back a bit. A little bit of modal textures to it. Certainly free jazz, but nothing too intense, nothing too screamy. But this quartet, I guess at the time, was sort of like a dominant quartet in the Scandinavian jazz scene, and it's on this Swedish label, Gazelle. Nice label design, actually. Let's show you this side. Gazelle. Yeah, listen to this one like two or three times. All the liner notes here are English, so you can check that out. Nice condition. This one, where did I get this? This one, I think I got this with the Okora record. Yeah, right, because this is from Sweden, so this I paired with that Okora Musique de Burundi. More. This one wasn't looking for this, but this is a cool story. Well, I forget where this came from, but I got this from Angry Mob. This is the original pressing from 1980 of the Chandra record, a post-punk record with the 12-year-old, 13-year-old Chandra. I think she was 12, who was the son of famous artists and sculptors. And I had the reissue of this, but I was looking for this, and this came into the collection of Angry Mob. And then unbelievably, a few days later, Chandra herself came into Angry Mom to rep some of her reissues that she was bringing in reissues from the label, doing these reissues these days. I think Telephone Explosion plus some other stuff. She was bringing her daughter to check out Ithaca College here. How crazy. And then this record's on the wall, which I didn't even know was on the wall. I walked in 2 days later, and I heard the story about she was there and the record was there. Thank God she didn't want to take it home or anything. So I've been looking for this, but not specifically. I've been waiting to see it maybe in a shop, and sure enough, I get to have this copy. And it has the big sound sticker on it, which I don't like. However, that sticker is near and dear to me because I used to go to that store all the time on St. Mark's Place in Manhattan. These stickers, if you know, you know. You've seen these stickers around. I don't know how easy they come off. I've never tried to get one off, to be honest. I've always been afraid to, because these stickers were intense. As was that place, kind of, in a way. 20 St. Mark's Place. Anyway, so Chandra came in to Angry Mom and saw her record on the wall at the same exact time. I have a photo of her. I'm going to put it in right here. But what is this record? A 12-year-old fronting a post-punk group with ex-members of Model Citizens and The Dance. And they did shows around New York, and she decided to, you know, she could have kept going and probably become a pretty big musician, but she decided to keep going to school, and she tried to come back to music later, but at that point it was too late, and the recordings that they made later are on the reissue that I also have, which I won't pull out now, but her dad was Dennis Oppenheim, a sculptor, and I think her mother was like he was a conceptual artist. I think she was a sculptor, if I have it right. I'm not sure. But they were very influential, very much on the art scene. I mean, she was going to see Steve Reich and Philip Glass when she was like 6. She was even performing in pieces with them. So obviously the pedigree was there. But this is an excellent 4-track EP. A little bit on the no wave side. But much more just post-punk and new wave. Yeah, she was hanging out with the coolest of the cool in the no wave scene. The no wave early 80s. This got some new life. The Avalanches, I guess, used one of these songs in their 2016 album, so it gave this record some new life. And I think there are two different reissues of it. I have the earlier reissue on the Cantor label. She plays organ too, melodica, but mainly she's the vocalist. Chandra, Transportation. I highly recommend this. Here's the original label. It's on the Go-Go label, which also did... what was it? It's out of Philly, this label. I think, oh yeah, Crash Course in Science. That is Chandra. This at the Rochester Dig. This is from 1979, and I just love this. I mean, Bismillah Khan is known for playing the shanai, which is like the reed instrument, and this is two beautiful ragas with the shanai. You know, Bismillah Khan is known as, just like I said, the not architect, but just he's most associated with that instrument. And yeah, he's just known as one of the most prestigious Indian classical musicians there are. So this is a pressing from, I think, 19 79 on the EMI Odeon. There it is. I mean, it's just, you know you're getting the ragas on one side. Morning and Night usually is what it typically is. But it talks about him on the back here. Born in 1916. Received his musical training from his uncle. It talks about, I think he finally left into, I think for a while he wanted to leave to play music abroad, but his associates, I guess you'd say, didn't want him to. However, he would eventually play, and says, in Edinburgh Festival in 1965, Commonwealth Arts and Festival in London as well. He and Ravi Shankar are the Indian musicians who have cut the largest number of LP discs. So yeah, side one, Yaman. Side two, the Brigadaban Sarang. It talks about that in the back here. This is a great one. This was at the Bop Shop. It was Malakhan. Next one was one of my 2023 targets. One of the ones, along with the Gil Scott Heron, that I kept seeing the most and trying to pin down the most, but couldn't find a good copy. This year I did. And this is one that I got from a Heritage auction. So I had to pay auction fees, but I got it for a price still less than what it was going for. This is a clean-ass copy of Jeannie Lee Conspiracy, 1975, on her own Earth Forms. I believe the Seeds pressing actually comes first, but it was the same year. She then issued this privately on her own. I'm not sure why, but this is funny. It comes with a letter of authenticity from the auction house. There it is, Heritage Auctions. Jeannie Lee Conspiracy first pressing stereo LP vinyl record. The lot of February 8th. Well, stoked to get this. I mean, here's the beautiful Earthforms label. It's a near mint or excellent on both. Earthforms, beautiful label. Now, this is primarily a vocal-led record, but it's not vocal jazz per se, although it is. But she's making the vocals do different things. She's giving space, this silence. She overdubs her own voice. She's not by herself, though. Gunter Hampel, her partner, is playing flute, piano, vibes, alto and bass clarinets. You have Steve McCall on bass. Sam Rivers is here, soprano and tenor sax and flute. And at this time was very much involved in the loft jazz scene. As well as Jack Gregg, bass. And you also have Perry Robinson, clarinet, Alan Praskin, clarinet, Mark Whitecage, alto clarinet, and Marty Cook, trombone. So they contribute as well. But it's Jeannie Lee's show. It's kind of a bit of like the Strata East meets the loft scene. It has that sort of vibe. Originally produced for C's Records by Jeannie Lee and Malt Exley. So, Earthforms in Bronx, New York. This is a New York record, of course. It feels like an improvised session. It feels like they're all sort of coming together, and all the arrangements have a lot of looseness and air to them, and Jeannie Lee's voice is really sort of the centerpiece. It just has like a real free-flowing kind of feel to it. There's lots of multiple layers. It's a beautiful record. It's an experience to sit and listen to this. I really love Jamaica, track 3. And these are her compositions. Mostly, you have a Gunter Hampel composition. You have a composition by the band. And then Jeannie Lee with a few other people. Jeannie Lee and Jack Gregg. So it's mainly all her music. She pushes this thing forward, though. It's a beautiful album, 1975. Conspiracy. There's the reissue that came out. It's pretty expensive in its own right. Obviously, this was more, but It was an important one for me to get because I do love when vocals are done right. And there's more Jeannie Lee to get, but just a beautiful edition of this copy. There's been records, I paid way less than the records that are been sitting on Discogs with like radio letters and, you know, detached seams and stuff. So really happy to have it. Just had to pay those dang auction fees and, you know, a $30 shipping tag.
As if.
I saw this band the week before WFMU in October. I'm just getting around now to fully processing this record by MSSV, aka Mainstream Stop Valve, Mike Watt, Stephen Hedges, and Mike Baghetta are MSSV. This is their second album, and it's amazing. Great. Sort of an angular, avant, almost Mission of Burma style record, but again, with space and a little bit of jazz. And it's really Mike Baghetta who's the leader on this record, and I actually got him to sign the record. Mike Watt was busy packing up, so I just got Mike to sign it. But yeah, they played at Anger Mom Records a week before WFMU, October 6th, I think it was. It's 500 of these, apparently. I'm sure it's still available. I don't think there's a huge demand for this, but they were great live, and this really captures it. But yeah, Baghetta is a great guitar player. Great. I love what he does. And Mike Watt sounds good on this. You know, they feel like a fully functioning band. It's like played these songs live so much that they sound really tight, but they also they have that feel of like they feel live and they're obviously lived in, but they know what they're doing, but it feels like they're writing them as they go in a way. Yeah, it's kind of a bit of a stripped down punk feel to it too, that angular sound with a bit of like free jazz spirit. And I like Hedges' vocals, and of course Mike Watt contributes. I said Hedges, but Baghetta. Hedges is the drummer. He's a great drummer too. He's played, they've all done, of course you know what Mike Watt's done, but Hedges and Baghetta have done some great stuff too with other bands. They're all accomplished. It was on the Big Eagle label. It came out last year, of course. MSSV, Human Reaction. Pretty long one, I think. There will be more Acid Archives videos coming, more other stuff, and that's about it. Thanks, and you all stay well, be good, till next time.